Tom Jones, that way, is called a novel that is centered around a character who can be described as Picaro, as a person who is an adventurer, a person who doesn't belong to one place, a person who keeps moving from one place to another without any specific job. So Tom Jones, the character, is this kind of a person, this kind of that can be categorized as Picaro, and Fielding is using him as a device, as a method to present for our benefit the world of 18th century England. So let's go further from the Picaresque novel to the actual incidents and situations that are presented in the novel. So both grow and develop as conscious beings, the consciousness marked by questioning and self-questioning. So both refers actually to two kinds of responses to life, and these responses appear to be contrasted with one another, but then they grow and develop together. And Tom Jones and his friends, Tom Jones and his foes, both of them develop as conscious beings. So what is a conscious being? I think you all know that if you are conscious about your own actions and you know that you are right here or that you are wrong here, then you know you are conscious. And consciousness actually is a quality that adds to value to your life. If you are conscious, then you will do something and at the same time judge yourself. So novel helps you in this, and the characters in this novel, in Tom Jones, they are conscious. So the consciousness marked by questioning and self-questioning. You question others. Somebody does something, you don't agree with him or her, and then you ask a question. That is called questioning. What is self-questioning? Self-questioning is that you don't bother about what others say, you bother about what you said. Suppose there is something that angered another person. You talked and the other person raised an objection and he said, "No, I don't like you because you have said such a thing." And then you sit back and think as to why something hurt the other person that you said. And then you realize that, well, when you were talking to him or her, then you were not aware of the situation in which, you know, the other person was placed. And therefore, you said something and that hurt him. And then you start thinking further, should I do it again? And your answer is to be, no, I will not do. I don't want to hurt anybody else. I want to merely let other people know what I think. And if they feel hurt, then I'll change my way. So when you change your way after self-questioning, you are a different person. So in fact, a good novel is that which always raises questions, not only about the world in which one lives, but also about what happens inside a person. So self-questioning that way is important. The process is truly fascinating. Obviously, if you live a life of consciousness, then you will interest many people. Other people will start, you know, empathizing with you. They will put themselves in your situation, and then, you know, they'll start relating their own with your kind of self. So writing becomes very educative, because when you read a novel, then you are facing certain situations, and those situations tell you about the world in which you live. And if it's a bad world, then you question. If it's a good world, you like it. And if it's a mixture, then you want to find out what is good and what is bad, and then you go inside yourself. So that way the whole thing is really engaging. So over a period, the reading of such a novel begins a process of new learning in society and the language itself. Language will develop. In the 18th century, in 1749, this novel is written and it becomes popular. It is so popular, in fact, that over a very short period, four or five editions of it appear, and all of them are lapped up by the readers. Why does it happen? That happens because the person who reads learns a lot about life and society. And more than that, the person who reads the novel also has an enriched understanding of language. Because when you are listening to different people speaking their dialogues in the novel, and all of them use a terminology that is not there in the case of one only, but different terminologies, then your language improves. In fact, language also is improved because you use a word in one sense, somebody else is using it in another sense, there is a third who mixes up, and some kind of experimentation goes all the time. So, you will find that people who interact in a novel through dialogue or through, you know, representation that somebody is talking about you, the writer is making a comment about you as a character, then, you know, language becomes of a different kind, it becomes experimental, and that experimentation of language also adds to the knowledge of language. So, Tom Jones, he makes mistakes. And when he makes mistakes, he gets into trouble, and then you start thinking about yourself. Tom Jones is a Picaro, and so all of us are Picaros in one sense or the other. In the evening, I would like to go to a neighborhood that I have not seen, and I will see something different. So, I come back and learn, and Tom Jones is doing it all the time. So, that is what Picaro's quality is, and in fact, if you start thinking about it, if I start thinking about it myself, then I realize that I have the sense of moving around aimlessly. Why not? So, we have a character here who moves around aimlessly, and yet he learns a lot. Anyway, I will return to this more and more as we discuss, but then the next point that I want to share with you is this. Apart from the hero, Tom Jones is the hero of this novel, an important character in the novel is Squire Allworthy. Now, just see, Tom Jones is a simple name, but what is the meaning of Allworthy? Why is he called Allworthy? Because he is a worthy person, because he is a person who is respected by people in the neighborhood, and he is a squire. He is a big person, he is a kind of a landlord, and he belongs to a very high family in society, and he has the title of being a squire. So, that is Squire Allworthy actually is the reigning deity, is a person who is worshipped by all the people in the area. And this person is very kind, he is very generous, he is very intelligent, he is very mature, he is very helpful. So, this squire is also there in the novel, and as I said, all characters have a history. So, you have his history also, that this person is senior, and he is heading a family, and in that family Tom Jones is born. And he is a distinguished country gentleman. Country means living in the countryside, in the village, and he owns a large number of villages and estates there. And he has an unmarried sister, Bridget Allworthy, his sister. So, now it comes to the story. He has a sister. And then what happens to the sister? To cut the long story short, she is actually the mother of Tom Jones, and nobody knows about it. Even Squire Allworthy does not know that Tom Jones's mother is this woman, Bridget. Why am I telling this? That is because in the novel it is said that Tom Jones's fatherhood is doubtful, that nobody knows who his father is. And Bridget also was revealed only later in the novel to be his mother, but somebody else was thought to be his mother. So he is a bastard child. It's not a matter of abuse in the 18th century, and the word was used literally. So anybody whose fatherhood was not known was called a bastard. And we have Tom Jones as a bastard hero in the novel. This itself raises some interesting questions. How can a writer choose for depiction a character who is a bastard? And should that person be respected? Society doesn't respect. People don't like such a person. They always criticize a person whose father is not known. It's a kind of a gali in almost all languages. And it's a gali also in English. But then see the courage of this writer Fielding, who is making this person a hero. So, that itself is questionable for most of us, that how can, earlier heroes used to be kings and great warriors and great statesmen, philosophers, they used to be heroes. But in the 18th century, a bastard child is made a hero. You can ask a whole question about a bastard child becoming a hero in a novel. And in fact, lots of causing of eyebrows might have happened. People would have at that point of time denigrated this person, Fielding, to give a kind of heroism to a character who is a bastard child. But then Henry Fielding doesn't bother about it. He doesn't bother about the criticism that might be heaped on him, and he would say, what's his mistake? If somebody's father is not known, somebody's fatherhood is not known, then how is the child responsible for this? The child is a child. The child can be born anywhere, and if the father has disappeared, if the father was irresponsible, if the father did not marry the woman, if the father just lived with the woman without social sanction, how is the child to blame for this? So this is a very revolutionary kind of idea in the 18th century, that a great novel is written about a bastard child. So who will look after him? Squire Ulverdy, has this child in his bed when he comes back from the city, and then he says, whose child is this? This is 1 day old or 2 days old, and he says, whose child is this? And somebody says, well, it might be the child of that woman over there. And after some time it is found out that it is of that woman perhaps, and then he says, okay, if nobody is there to look after him, then I'll look after this child. So that's how Tom Jones is growing. So imagine, the hero is born in very dubious circumstances. Dubious, I'm not using the word from my own side, people will call him dubious. His whole thing, questionable in that sense. And what does Squire Ulverdy do? And that's why I was praising him, I was calling him generous. Then he said, well, it's a child, and if nobody takes him under one's shelter, then he will take him under his own shelter, and he will arrange a kind of education for him, let him grow up, he'll nurture him, he'll bring him up, and finally this person will be important in society. So that is the perspective of Squire Ulverdy. And the moment you hear about Squire Ulverdy thinking of this, then you realize that, well, this is what is called, genuine generosity. This is not, something wrong on the part of this person. He is not swayed by the prejudices of society, and he's doing something good to this child who will later on grow into a responsible citizen, hopefully. So, there are two people who are made his tutors. And one person is a philosopher, Square, and the Reverend Thwackum. These are the two tutors he has. And then he has a servant called Black George. And Black George is a person away from the main place where Tom Jones lives. And therefore, sometimes Tom Jones goes to him also. And in the meantime, he has grown up. And he has grown up, let's say, 17 years, 18 years. All this while, and then he is given education by these two tutors, and he gets some experience from the servant Black George. That's how his training begins. Now, let me tell you something interesting about this character, Tom Jones, that he doesn't have any moral sense. And he's a very handsome boy, if he meets a girl, then the girl would fall in love with him. And in the 18th century, the love tradition among the common masses is not the same as the love tradition in the upper classes. So this person goes to the servant Black George, and who has daughters, and one of the daughters is so enchanted with him that she wanted to be intimate with him physically, and Tom Jones doesn't know about wrong or right, good or bad, and he would say, okay, if she wants to be physically intimate, then he doesn't bother. So imagine a bastard child not marrying another girl, and the girl is encouraging him to be intimate with him, and he doesn't find it wrong or right, and therefore later on it is he also is told by somebody that the girl became pregnant, and then she gave birth to somebody, and that child was actually his child. Whether he was his child or not is not to be established easily, but then Tom Jones says, okay, if that's the child, then he'll accept that child as his child. So this is the kind of thing that Tom Jones does, and the writer doesn't bother about discussing this question morally. That is being discussed by others, and the writer allows those people to discuss the way they like. That, you know, brings in the theme of hypocrisy in the novel. So this novel is about the evil of hypocrisy, that you know the philosophers, the teachers, and others, they say one thing for public consumption, and they do something else in their own lives. So the teachers of Tom Jones, they also do the same, that they condemn him, but in their own life they are as bad as Tom Jones would be. Tom Jones is not bad because he doesn't do anything consciously, but those people are doing it under a plan. They hide their weaknesses, they hide their evil ways, and they keep telling others that Tom Jones is a bad person. So this writer in the 18th century is talking about a society in which most of the important people are hypocrites. They say one thing and do its opposite, and that's a bad thing. And actually, this is a novel which is going to question social morality from this angle, that when you become moral in your speech, then you are hypocrite, because you don't follow those principles in your own life. And that is what the tutors of Tom Jones are doing. So Tom and Black George's feisty daughter, Molly Seagrim, that's her name, relate well with each other, and Tom Jones thinks that he has fathered her child. So you have a bastard hero, and then this person also has himself, without marrying a woman, made her pregnant, and then he has fathered her child. Squire Western and his daughter Sophia Western are also important characters. The latter is the heroine who finally marries Tom. Just see, Squire Allworthy's son, let's say, adopted son, Tom Jones, is going to marry another squire's daughter, and then they are equal in status. Maybe Squire Allworthy is a little superior, and Sophia is the daughter of Squire Western, and the two finally will marry. So already you know that it's a comic epic poem in prose. So comedy means the hero finally will marry and settle down properly. So that is the plot line in the novel, that even though Tom Jones has episodes of friendship and intimacy with other women, when it comes to marriage, then he will marry the heroine, and that heroine, you know, also would take courage to marry such a person, and the heroine is impressed by him, in spite of the fact that he is not very disciplined in his habits. This person, Sophia, she finds him much better than many others. So she, in her opinion, he is the best in the world at that time. So she says, okay, everybody is hypocrite, this person not hypocrite. This person says what he does, and he's a truthful one, and he loves everybody, and he loves them genuinely. But what is wrong in that? So it's a different kind of a heroine. It's not a heroine who bothers about chastity. Chastity is there, her virtue. She is a chaste person. She also likes chastity, but the world is such that nobody else is chaste. So what should she do? Then she should marry for love, and she loves Tom because the qualities that he has, he is very helpful. So if he sees somebody in distress, he'll be very sympathetic. He will always go out of the way to give protection, to give any kind of monetary help or whatever help is required. And this has impressed this woman, and therefore she says, okay, this person I love, and him I am going to marry. And finally, Tom Jones is going to settle down with her, and he does so after a series of experiences, a series of adventures that he has gone through. And when I say a series of adventures and a series of situations, what I say is that he is actually having his education in life. How are we educated in life? One way to be educated in life is to go to a school, read books, come out, and you learn knowledge that way from teachers, and then you get a job, and finally you establish yourself. That is what education is for us. But no, actual education is that where you just interact with people and learn from them, and they learn from you. That's the process, and that kind of education is shown as happening in the case of Tom. He has married a large number. He has met a large number of people, and he has had some episodes of love with one or another. But he finds that people generally cheat him, and he learns very late all these things. But then he has learned. So a kind of education has occurred, and that education occurred because he went through all those people's experiences, and he found most of them wrong and bad. And it's a different kind of a world in 18th century England. It's a country where lots of rogues and depraved people live. It also is a country where lots of good people live. So when he goes from one village to another, when he has to run away from Squire Allworthy because Squire Allworthy was angry with him once or twice, so he ran away from there. He went to England. There also he impressed people. He impressed women. And one woman, wanted to marry him, and she was older than him. And then, she also organized something wrong against another person. It goes on and on. There are lots of episodes. But the basic crux of this novel is that Tom Jones is learning from each mistake that he makes in the novel. And finally, the word is final here. The word finally, he marries the heroine. Now, I'll tell you a few more things and finish the discussion. First, I'll talk about the narrator in the context of the novel. The story is simple, that Tom Jones is a bastard hero, is born as a child, he grows up, he meets a large number of people, and he finally marries a woman who deserves to marry him and whom he deserves to marry. So, and it's going to, end up as a novel of the education of Tom Jones. But a few aspects of this novel are also to be considered, from the point of view of fiction, and I'll just discuss these two concepts with you before I end the discussion today. The first is the narrator. Who is the narrator in the novel? Well, generally you would say the person who writes the novel is the narrator. If I tell you a story, then I'm the narrator. If you tell me a story, you are the narrator. But sometimes it so happens that the writer asks somebody else to narrate or assumes the role of a narrator, but whatever the narrator says is not the opinion of the author. I hope you get the point, that I tell you a story and I tell you a story in such a manner that you start laughing and you don't take me seriously. And maybe I'm a serious person. If I'm a serious person and I'm making you laugh, and I'm telling you jokes and I don't say anything serious, but the serious thing is led to, then perhaps I'm not talking in my voice. I'm not talking as myself. I'm talking as somebody else. Is that possible? Well, in English, this kind of a thing happened in the case of this novel, that whatever the narrator says is not necessarily right. The narrator says lots of things that are irresponsible. The narrator says something to praise Molly Seagrim, that girl, who in a way enticed Tom Jones to go to bed with him, and the girl enjoyed all this. Now, do you think that's the opinion of the writer Henry Fielding? You might think so, that Henry Fielding is actually telling the reader that this kind of a thing is right or wrong. But would you say this? Would a writer of the caliber of Henry Fielding say all that himself? Perhaps no, because he is actually assuming the voice of somebody else. This happens sometimes, and good writers do that. Good writers always tell you a story, but then while telling the story, they present it in such a manner that wrong things are said in the story. So you are supposed to find those wrong things out. I just give you the example of Shakespeare himself. Shakespeare says many things through his characters, but you can't say those characters represented Shakespeare. For instance, I'm doing a bit here in order to digress from the, going away from the topic, but I tell you, in Shakespeare, there is a character who says, "Frailty, thy name is woman. Weakness, thy name is woman." Weakness and woman are the same. Now, the character is saying this, but can you say Shakespeare said it? Most of us wrongly say Shakespeare said it, but that was not his opinion. So who has said it? The character said it. The character in the situation, he said that a woman is generally weak. So the same way, if the character says it or if the writer says it in the voice of the character, then you can't say that, this is the opinion of the author. So in this novel, there is a narrator who is sometimes praising Tom Jones, sometimes he is opposing him, sometimes he is opposing somebody else, and he is raising questions, and that narrator has an independent role to play in the novel. So this is a novel that is to be read with great care, because what is said in the novel, what is presented in the novel is not exactly the opinion of the author. The author is only presenting different opinions, and you can't ascribe any opinion to him. So he is giving you a chance to take your own decisions regarding the issue that he is raising. So when you read this novel, you always keep in mind that whatever is said is to be called wrong or right by your judgment. But the writer will not say, he will not attest anything as wrong or right himself. This is one. Secondly, I gave you the example of digression. What is a digression? When I am not talking on the point, I straight away brought in Shakespeare and I started digressing. So this is actually, the novel is using lots of digressions in the novel. There are many episodes in the novel which do not relate directly to the main plot. So what do you say? The writer starts talking about philosophy, the writer starts talking about tragedy, the writer starts talking about another country, another literature, and there are pages and pages written like this. They are called digressions. What is digression? When you go off the track, when you are not talking about the story, when you are not talking relevant things, when you are talking about irrelevant things. What is the role of irrelevant things in life? Think about it, because the writer is using a very good use of the irrelevant thing in society, an irrelevant thing in the novel, and he is making some points regarding problems that Tom Jones or his associates do not face. So I end on this, that this novel is very educative, because it is in fact telling you about different issues and opinions about those issues that clash with one another. So it's a whole novel about a society where you can't say this thing is important, that thing is important, because all that is contained in the society as a whole. So I conclude by saying that this novel is a big novel. This novel has a large number of characters and situations, and it has a lot of issues to raise, and you are not supposed to agree or disagree with anything, but then you are compelled to think about the issues that the writer has raised. So I say this is one of the finest novels written by an English writer in the last 300 years or so, and that in those 300 years, this novel is one of the outstanding novels, for the reason that it talks about education of the reader, education of the characters in the novel, particularly Tom Jones, and he makes hero a person who is not supposed to be there in the novel at all. So all these things, and it's a comic novel, so all these things make it is one of the most valuable contributions to the origin and development of fiction. Thank you.